BBC foreign affairs correspondent. I was based in Moscow in the late 1990s during the second term of President Yeltsin. And I met Boris Berezovsky at that time and interviewed him when he was very much at the heart of the Russian establishment. Since then, you all know that he is no longer at the heart of the Russian establishment. Indeed, he has fallen out spectacularly with the Russian establishment. What I plan to do is ask him a few questions of my own, and then I know that all of you will have many questions that you will want to put to him. We're delighted to welcome him to our club as our guest, and so I know that there will be many people who will disagree with him, but he's our guest, and we're pleased to welcome him. Mr. Berezovsky, only 7 months ago, Alexander Litvinenko sat where you're sitting and addressed the club in this room, and about 3 weeks after he appeared here, he was poisoned. Let me start by asking you the question that is in the news now. Do you believe what Mr. Lugovoy said at that press conference in Moscow 2 or 3 days ago?
First of all, thank you very much for your invitation to join you tonight. Yes? It's not... I have two microphones, I don't know what to do.
Can we do something with the sound over there? Boost Mr. Berezovsky's sound?
Is okay?
That's better.
Okay, again, thank you very much that you invite me to join you this evening. Yeah. As far as Lugovoy is concerned, a long time I know him, and moreover, not just know, he protect myself, and he protect my family. And even today, when Crown Prosecutor Office defined him as a killer, let's say, yes, it's very complicated for me to accept that. Yeah. I just tell you that he called me after Litvinenko already died, and it was maybe months after, and he called to my office and said that, do I really believe that he is back of that, yes? And I said, it's a very strange impression. On the one hand, I can't accept that emotionally, yes? But as a fact is concerned, it's so that he is. And I told him, look, and exactly, I told him exactly the same. I told him, look, if you really sure that you are not involved in this plot, take a plane, come here, and go to Scotland Yard. And I tell you, I told him not because just abstract and so, because I have personal experience in this country. When I came here as oligarch, as a who is a robber baron and who is steal money and so, and I was asking political asylum in this country, and government refused that. They didn't grant me political asylum. And I went to the court, and I proved, and it took more than a year to prove that I'm not guilty, I'm not money laundering, and so and so. And it's a lot of evidence of that, yes? And I was granted political asylum, and British government refused to extradite me after that. And I said, it's a country of really where government is not able to do anything if they really even wish to do, because there is an independent judicial system here. And I guarantee you, if you are not guilty, 100% you will not be in jail. Yeah, I'll give you the best lawyer of this country, because it's not only money sense, it's also knowledge, who is good, who is bad, yes, and I have this knowledge. And he said, okay, look, I should look. And the second I said, but it's just emotion, yes? But there is another point. There is polonium trace follow you all over the Europe, and even through my office.
Yeah, but and we all know that. What I'm asking you is, as a friend of Alexander Litvinenko, and also as an old friend of Lugovoy, do you believe that Lugovoy killed Litvinenko?
You see, it's impossible to answer just yes or no, yeah? And that's the reason why, just to present to you my position. Even now, I'm not sure. On the one hand, I'm sure 100% that investigation was correct, that investigation was professional, because I tell you that I communicate a lot with Scotland Yard, with people and so, who try to find what is reality, yes? And again, I watch Lugavoy by Russian TV several days ago, and again, I have a very strange impression. What, if you want my feeling, not understanding, yes? I think that he was involved in that, but some people are behind of him. And he did not understand really what they plan, yes? Definitely he was involved in plot, no doubts. For me, no doubts. But was he a figure who put the poison in Alexander Litvinenko's cup? I'm not sure.
Or if he did, perhaps he didn't know. Is that your...
Sorry?
If he did take part in it, you think maybe...
I don't think that he's so naive. And I think that he was, according to my understanding, he was a communicator. Those one who brought people close to Alexander. And he understood more or less which position he took, yes? But I'm not sure that he was the exactly person who poisoned him.
Let me ask you about President Putin. When did you first meet him?
I met him the first time at the very beginning of 90. It was St. Petersburg, and I was introduced to him by Mr. Avan, who is today the chairman of Alpha Bank. And I traveled that time with some Americans, businessmen, and we traveled to St. Petersburg, and we had some business meeting, and it was Mr. Sobchak there, who was mayor, and Mr. Putin, who at that time was deputy of Mr. Sobchak, responsible for international commercial relations. And that was the first time when I met.
And what did you think of him when you first met him?
You see, I didn't have any special impression, yeah? But that time we started to develop business with Daimler, with Mercedes-Daimler. That time that were not Mercedes, Chrysler, right? Yes, and we already created a workshop, the first in Russia, in Moscow. And we want to increase our power in different regions. And the first after Moscow was St. Petersburg. And I asked Putin help to develop that. And he was very, very useful with that. And moreover, he was the first bureaucrat which I met that time who didn't ask some money for that and so. And he was absolutely professional in that.
So he helped you expand your business?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, and he helped us to get the place and to build workshop in.
Why? Why did he do that?
You see, I think that he was sincere because he really understood that it's very important for Russia to develop commercial relations with the West because it's just the beginning of capitalism in Russia. And everything what he delivered that time was absolutely in frame of his professional job.
And did you stay in touch with him? Did you see him often during the 1990s?
Yeah, we become not close friends, but we become friends. And I invite him, I think maybe a couple months later to Switzerland. And he joined me in Switzerland with his friend Sechin, who is also well known today. And my wife, she was also in Switzerland, and we spent maybe less than a week, maybe 5 days together. And then we start to communicate much more. And again, I want to stress that it was very unusual. I want, maybe you, it's complicated maybe to accept in this country because I spent already 6 years in this country and I understand that it's no corruption here at all. At least I But in Russia at that time it was absolutely a regular way, and I was really excited that he never sent any messages that he want money or something like that. And nevertheless, step by step, we create very, very close relations.
So he was living on his state salary all that time, when everybody else in those circles.
It's the other point. I don't know. Yes, I just know that as far as B is concerned, our relations was absolutely not corrupted. Yes, I don't know. Did he have any relations with the other? Like today, many people discuss that he had connections with criminal people in St. Petersburg and so, and maybe they have evidence of. I don't have this evidence.
Tell me about the period in the late 1990s when President Yeltsin was nearing the end of his second term. It was very urgent for the Yeltsin political family, and you were in the political family, to find a successor to President Yeltsin who would protect the family.
I absolutely disagree with your question, yes, because I know that a lot of speculation about who was Yeltsin unfortunately was today, yes, and that his family, who he was all the time he was drunk, he didn't understand what he was doing. It's absolutely...
No, I didn't.
You mentioned the term family, yes? Mm-hmm. And I disagree. Because family means like mafia, kind of Russian, yes? And it's absolutely wrong. Yeah, I know that it's well developed on the West, that it was family.
Well, it was well developed in Russia. This term came from Russia. It's not a Western invention.
No, it's parallel. I disagree with you. It's parallel vision from the West and from the Russia, and you just interrupt me, and it's exactly what I want to add, yes? And in Russia at the same time. Because I want to tell you that Yeltsin has had, Yeltsin revolution had strong resistance from KGB and communists, yes? And they create a lot of propaganda, yes? Against of Yeltsin, and particularly against of people who were close to him, yes? Like me, for example, yes? And I never tried to be isolated from him. I never said that I am not with Yeltsin, I am not with his team, yes? Team is correct word. It's true, yes?
Okay.
We're team of him, yes? And it's, I think it's absolutely happened naturally, because many people who were not known at all in Soviet time crowded him after he took power, like Gaidar, who knew Gaidar before, who knew Chebwais before, who knew, let's say, so-called oligarchs, yes, before, yeah? And I just want to stress that we believe, as far as me is concerned, and many people around him, we believe what he tried to do, yeah? And I tell you, I never had, let's say, parents who were involved in Communist Party activity, or who were rich, who were influenced. I was just regular Soviet, homo sovieticus, yes? Regular, yeah? And I just believe what he was doing, and I try to support him. And,
okay.
And I absolutely disagree that Yeltsin was not was person who was under control of so-called family. I tell you,
okay.
Yeltsin, all the principal decisions Yeltsin made himself.
Okay. Tell me about the time when Putin began to emerge as the key person to succeed. How did that happen?
It's impossible to discuss that without context. Yeah, mm-hmm. I tell you that what I feel. I don't have knowledge. Yes, just my feeling. I think that Yeltsin really was a liberal. I don't know why, because he passed all the steps of communist career. Yes, but he really, as I know, my knowledge and my feeling, he was a real liberal. On the one hand. On the other hand, deep in his mind, he didn't believe that he will leave this chair. It means that he didn't prepare the successor, yes? And he started really to think this seriously just at the late 98, yeah? Mm-hmm. And if you remember, he started to change the Chernomyrdin, mm-hmm. then Kiriyenko, let's say I was against completely of Kiriyenko, but again, it just stressed that he was independent. He just not was puppet, yes? And then he changed again his mind and put Primakov. Mm-hmm. But I want again to stress that it was the time when we have, at the same time, economical and political crisis. Mm. And Primakov was really maybe only one who was able to settle that.
Yes.
It's not to allow society to fight. Yes. And then he recognized that Primakov is moving back. He increased power of communists. And so again, he changed his mind and put Stepashin. Mm-hmm. Again. And it means that he just on the one hand, he recognized that, as a rational point, he took a decision to leave. As an emotional point, he never accepted that until the last moment, I think so.
But none of these people, Primakov, Kiryenko certainly, Stepashin, none of these people were a possible president. Until suddenly, in 1999, Putin. Why Putin?
You're absolutely wrong. Everyone, because it's absolutely different, mentality in this country, for example, on the West in general, but particularly in this country and in Russia. People pay attention not to personality, but the chair. And I was absolutely sure that those one who will become prime minister will be next president. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and it's not just my emotions and my personal estimation, but if you return back to numbers and the pools of that time, who knew Kiryenko before he became prime minister? No one, mm-hmm. no one. But in 2 months, his rating became 20%. Mm. Yeltsin, the time rating was 5%. Mm. Yes, he became 20%. He changed Kiryenko to Primakov. Primakov was known, but his rating was 1%. In 2 months, his rating became 40%. He fired Primakov, put Stepashin, and in 2 months, Stepashin became 20% rating. Okay, it just demonstrates that people, it was important that Yeltsin, people hate him, but it doesn't matter, because he put in the chair, big chair, mm-hmm. and people believe in that, yes? Mm-hmm.
Okay, but I accept that's very interesting and important, but why was Putin in the end the one? And describe the process, because you were still close to Yeltsin
at that time. I start from the end point, yes? I remember how he was introduced to Yeltsin, and after that Yeltsin said, not bad, but why it's so small? because Yeltsin was really, you see, how to say it? Okay, because after he died, and it was many discussion about who was Yeltsin and so, and Yeltsin is real Russia, I would like to say you. And very, very strong and very special, but very usual Russian man, yes? And I just want to tell you that definitely I support Putin. I support Putin and I trust that Putin. And I just want to mention one important point, that Putin took this position as a successor of Yeltsin, yes? Mm. As a successor. What it means? That he's supposed to continue reform, which Yeltsin started, yeah? And today we know that he is traitor, because unfortunately, it's turned out that he turned Russia back, not following Yeltsin reform, yeah? And I think that, I tell you, that I don't think that Yeltsin was good in understanding of personality. He made a lot of mistakes as far as personality. You remember Grachev, who was Minister of Defense, who started the war. He didn't start the war in Chechnya, but Korzhakov, maybe the best example, who was very close to Yeltsin. Yeltsin trusted him 100%. And you know maybe that Korzhakov became even godfather of his grandson. Yeah? And later on, turned out that Korzhakov is completely...
Okay, but let me take you back to that period in 1998-99. Did you discuss Putin with Yeltsin?
Yes.
And how did that discussion go?
I discuss more. I tell you the story that Putin was just one from several who was a candidate for successor. Yes, it was Mr. who was a minister of a railroad, Aksyonenko. Unfortunately, he died 1 year ago. And it was Mr. Nikolaev, who was a general of defense, let's say. And some, not a lot, but some people around. And I was one who support Putin, and I was one who discussed with Yeltsin about him and my impression, personal impression. And moreover, when Yeltsin finally took a decision in favor of Putin, he asked me to speak to him and to invite him to meet him, to meet Yeltsin. Yeah, that time Putin was in on the north of France, in Biarritz. Yes, Biarritz. Yeah, and he asked me to travel there. It was July 99. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I traveled there and I meet him. I met him with his family. Again, very, very simple, not luxurious hotel and so. Putin, Vladimir, his wife, Ludmila, and two his daughters. And I came there and I spent a day, lunch and after lunch, to discuss about that. And it was not first discussion, mine with him, because the first time I spoke about that with him at the beginning of 99, in the winter, yeah? And he was not prepared for that. And that time I spoke to him and he said, okay, it's very complicated for me. I'm not sure. But I take a decision after my meeting with Yeltsin. Do you think I meet him? I said, definitely. I just messenger, yes, nothing more. And he said, okay, I meet him. I like to meet him. I don't know what happened in front of them except of this this story that he said that he is nice, but...
Too small. Okay, I'm sure lots of people will want to come back to that. Let's move forward now. So, 1999, 31st of December, Yeltsin suddenly says, that's it, I'm finished. I'm finished at midnight. You know, I don't know if you remember, on the millennium, President Yeltsin managed to upstage an event that only happens once every 1,000 years by announcing his decision. And by January the 1st, Putin is acting president. At what point, and by 2001, you are here in London in exile. At what point between the 1st of January 2000 and you coming here to London, what was the first time you started to think, this guy is not good?
Okay, first of all, it's not definitely for the world. It was occasionally that Yeltsin, 31st of December, present his position. It's technology. Definitely it was technology, how to push Putin to become president, yes. It's the first point. The second point, definitely I start to have, let's say, doubts when he start this war in Chechnya. Because in 1996-97, I was a deputy of Security Council of Russia. Yeah? And I was deeply involved in Chechnya problem. Yeah? It was exactly my job, yes, to create a peace in Chechnya. And I spent 1.5 year and very complicated negotiations with Chechen separatists and so. And finally, in May 1997, we reached a peaceful agreement, the first for the 4 centuries between Russia and Chechnya, yes? And it was very, very complicated. I understood well, I think. Not because of this negotiation, because when I was 6 years old, the first time I traveled to Caucasus area, and that time every year, the first with my grandmother, next my own, and I knew a lot about this region, yeah, and a lot about this mentality, how it's complicated. And when he started the second war, I was deeply involved in understanding, yes? And I understood from the beginning that this was provocation 100%. Because what happened in Dagestan was provocation of FSB. Because there were a lot of people inside of top level authorities in Russia who were not prepared to accept the result of the first war. And they want revenge, yes? And Putin was on the top of that. And when he started this war, and this explosion of houses and so on, we may go to, into details, but I met, as I told you, we were friends, yes? I met him many, many times, anytime I want, yes? And I tried to explain him that it's wrong, no chance to win. And he just, you must say, disagree with that. But he was decision maker, not me decision maker. I just was consultant. Yes?
So when did you have that conversation with him, trying to persuade him that he could not win the Chechen war?
From August from August the 99 up to September, October, November, but particularly in December 99, when our troops reached the Terek River, mm-hmm. It's a principal position, and I told him, look, Vladimir, the victory is not flag over the Grozny. The victory means that Chechen accept that they lost, and that time they accept that, yeah? And we should stop and start to negotiate and reach agreement.
And why did he not agree with you?
I think today, that time I didn't understand. I think that he had some imperial emotions, yes? He just want to demonstrate that we are so big power and we are able to press them up to the down.
Or do you think he really had those emotions himself, or did he simply recognize the value of that emotion in most Russian people?
No. I think that he like him himself. I explain why. I just want to stress that what he is doing today and what he present for the world is absolutely sincere. He is like that. He presents his sincere position. He really believes that Russia able to be effective, only be centralized politically. He tried to put under control business and so. Definitely he is not like Brezhnev, but many people compare him today. Maybe a different story. When I start my business with German, yes, and I like to do to operate because it's very simple because I understood them well, and finally I formulate for myself that German are civilized Russian, yeah, because they really create rules as Russian don't create, yes, but emotions are the same, and I tell you that definitely Putin is absolutely Sovietic. Yes, and he is really believe what he is doing. I'm sure it's turned out last time for you and for me, unfortunately, that he is not so clever man, but he's sincere. I don't have any doubts.
Why did you decide to come to Britain?
When I start to have conflict, real conflict. Yes, with him, and many again many speculation that I just because I want to protect my money, and so you may have your vision, and I never try to push you against of that. But the problem is Chechnya was just the first point. The second point was his decision to eliminate power of governors. That he took responsibility that prosecutor office able to open the case against of governors, and they should leave the position. It's completely against of constitution because government are elected and no one prosecutor able to fire them, yes? And I wrote open letter addressed to Putin in May, at the end of May of 2000. I disagree with that. First, I have discussion with him. I tried to explain him personally. He didn't accept that and said, okay, I take open position. He said, okay, take open position. And I wrote letter and so on. And it's the second point. And the final point was between that, because I was a MP of Russian parliament and so, and I left my position, my own, because I disagreed that he tried to put parliament under control of Kremlin. It's against of constitution again. And finally, when the submarine, Kursk submarine, was sank, TV, which I control, the first, BBC One, yeah, in this country. Was very critical against of Putin, and he invited me and we had the final discussion. He said, why you fight against of me? It's just kitchen, I'm sorry to say, yes. And it was our final discussion, because he said, I want my personally to control this channel. I said, okay, come on. I'm not prepared for that. And after that, he put in jail my friend, my close friend, which he know also well. And after that, I left Russia. I spent 1 year in France, 2000. And then I came to Britain. And exactly that time, it was announced that I am under international arrest. And I took a decision to stay in there.
Let me ask you one last question before I invite questions from the floor. When you look back at the early 1990s and the way in which the Russian economy, the planned economy, the Soviet economy, was liberalized, and the way it enabled a small number of people to become very rich and plunged most Russians into greater poverty, first of all in the early 90s and then again in 1998 when the ruble collapsed, do you accept that a lot of what is happening now in Russia is a reaction to the system that you were part of and that made you rich at the expense of most Russian people?
Partly correct, but not a general point. I just tell you my personal way, yes, and my personal vision because of that. I passed through absolutely regular Soviet career, being Jewish, and understanding that I am not able to participate in political life. I don't want to say that I love that time, but nevertheless, I didn't like that I have limitations, yes? But I spent 30 years in science, in mathematics. And I absolutely enjoyed that, yes? And more I tell you, maybe what is not usual, that I, when I was 14, I planned my life for the next 30 years. In the next 30 years, step by step, I reach what I want when I was just 14. Yeah? And when I recognized that the Soviet Union is starting to collapse, was starting to collapse and so on, I changed my mind and moved and so on. And I think that everyone that time who really believed in himself at the end of 80s, at the beginning of 90s, was able to do exactly what I have done. Yeah, because I tell you, I described myself. Yes, I was very successful as a mathematician. I got PhD, professor, even member of Russian Academy of Science. What, just 800 people for all Soviet Union, 300 millions, and everybody, even Brezhnev, want to be member of Russian Academy of Science. Yes, and I recognized that something wrong. And I was in. I spent, as I told you, many years in science and in the same Institute of Controlled Sciences. And there were 2,000 people. And when I decided to move in business, everyone of 2,000 said, "Are you crazy?" But I said no, because 2 months they already didn't give me salary, and I didn't understand how it's possible in Soviet system not to pay salary. Yeah. And I moved to the business. And I just tell you, everyone who recognizes that it's time of changing become successful. It's a different story how they operate with that. Some people just make million or 2 millions, move to the islands and forget about everything. But some people continue their way. And I think that I just want to tell you that I never accept that I have done something criminal, yes? Nothing. Moreover, I prove in this country. But as far as moral sense is concerned, it's a different story, yeah?
But that's my question. I mean, I wouldn't accuse you of doing something criminal. What I'm saying is, do you regret the system which you were able to use to make you rich? Do you now regret that that opportunity was available in the way that it was available?
No. I tell you that we become free. And it's a very unusual feeling. Free means I don't pay attention more to state who controlled me before. Mm-hmm. I am able to do everything I want, yes? I just tell you again, simple story, how I made really big money, yes? Because I start with my professional knowledge developing software, yeah? Mm-hmm. And because I thought that business is based on the pure professional knowledge, mm-hmm. and I made some millions in rubles that time, yeah? But one day I came to Germany and went to the second to the workshop and watched the second-hand car, Mercedes. And at that time, maybe 10 Mercedes used in Russia at all, yes? And I recognized that it's just 5,000 D-mark. And I bought that and drive myself to Russia and sold it for $15,000. It's a big profit. Then I took my friends, 10 of them, moved to Germany. we bought another Mercedes. And it's the point where I recognize what means business. Business means that people want and I deliver. Yeah? And that time in Soviet, yes, it's still Soviet mentality, people wish just 2 points. Car and apartment. Nothing more. It was the first priority. Moreover, I tell you that that time the car and the apartment had the same value. Let's say you may buy the or Mercedes or two bedrooms apartment. It's the same price, yeah? And I recognize that it's a business, yeah? And we start to develop relations with different international companies like Mercedes, Volvo, and so on and so. And we become, let's say, in 1991, our company already got $120 million. It's absolutely amazing, yes? And just because I tell you, maybe 5% of population believe in reforms. 95% of population thought that it will collapse, state take everything back and put you in jail. Yeah, this is just your feeling. And if you ask me, do I regret? Definitely, I now understand much more than that time, and maybe in small points I changed my mind, because as far as morality is concerned, I did not feel that I am immoral that time, because I tell you that I use just my personal knowledge, my personal understanding, nothing as far as corruption is concerned, and nothing as far as my parents, past is concerned, and I just believe what I was doing.
Okay, well, let's get some questions from the floor. Thank you very much. This is just a taster of what we're going to get. Let's. The man at the side there who had his hand up first. Can you when I call you to speak? Can you just wait for the microphone to get you? Yes.
Hi, Boris. Thank you, Alan, by the way, for submitting some.
I just ask you to use easy English, okay? Okay. That I understand that.
That wasn't for you, anyways. That was for Alan.
Okay. It means that I am not answering.
Thank you, Boris, for showing up. My question is about your personal security, and I should admit that it's related because I work in the same office building as you. But I want to know what you do for personal security, what you're worried about, and like, are you comfortable in London? Is it difficult? I mean, what's your life like, and you leave the UK? All those types of questions.
Yeah, okay. I just tell you that Alexander Litvinenko told me, as a professional, he said, Boris, it's possible to fight person against of person, impossible to fight person against of system, yeah? And if they decide to kill us, they will kill us. I share this vision, yes? If, let's say, Kremlin, Putin, intelligence service in Russia decide to kill me, I don't have any chance to survive, yeah? The point is different, how I feel that, yes? Do every day I worry about that, and I try to hide myself and my family. No, I unfortunately, even being in Russia, I had bodyguards. Initially, it was not so simple to emotionally to accept that someone all the time follow you 24 hours. Yeah. Finally, okay, I'm strong as a psychology is concerned. Yes, I sleep well all the time. Yes, and even when I was under extradition warrant, I also slept well. Yeah, and but definitely I try to protect myself, but in very simple way, because again, if system decide to kill me, they do that, they deliver that. Yes, but okay, the first call I had in 1994, when it was attack against of me, my driver was killed in front of me, my bodyguard was damaged seriously. Yeah. And it was a choice, from my personal choice, what to do after that, or to hide, or to accept that as a second life, yes, which I was gift, yes, and I took the second way. It's natural. It's not I'm playing game in front of you, yeah. And I took a decision that I just try to protect myself, but I don't want to be hide, yes. And this, and as far as this country is concerned, I feel very safety, very safety. And I tell you that definitely when I moved here, and as I told you before, government refused my political my request for political asylum, and so, and they checked me a lot, and I had one accident very on the final stage. It's very funny. I have a car, armed car. Now, not I had before, and their backup car and motorcycle, yeah. And one day they move to have a fuel, yeah. One night they said we want to fuel the car. I said okay. 20 minutes later, my bodyguard called me and said, "Boris, impossible." I said, "What happened?" He said, "Your principal car is stolen." Armed car, special order from Mercedes, yes, and it's stolen. I don't want to go into details how it was stolen, because it's okay. Still now I have some feeling how it was happened, but it's impossible without very, very professional, yes, because it, 5 bodyguards, yes, and car was stolen, yeah. And I called to my wife and said, "Elena, look, it's happened." And she's very special woman. She said, "Boris, don't worry. In 2 days, it will be in front of our house." And it's happened. It's true. In 2 days, exactly in 2 days, it was in 400 meters in front of our house.
Did she steal it?
Yes, yeah, she organized that. Yes, and the problem was that in the car was a money, some small money, but our documents, which were never able to restore because Russian embassy didn't like that. Yes, and everything was in absolutely in the same way like it was. But after that, in a month, I was granted political asylum and so on.
But when I came to see you in Moscow in 1998 or 9. I had to go through metal detectors and empty my pockets, and it was like trying to get in to see George Bush. Do you still live behind that kind of security here in London?
I will answer to this question. I feel safety. And I'm sure that I'm not able to protect myself. Yes, just using my bodyguards and so on. If this country really, if this government really want to protect me, they are not, let's say, 100%, they don't have 100% power for that, but I feel that they're friendly to protect me.
Okay. John Owen, yeah.
Mr. Berezovsky, didn't your interview in The Guardian that essentially called for the overthrow of Putin do a number of things? Didn't it undermine the British investigation into the Litvinenko killing, play into the hands of Putin, and also make it virtually impossible for the British to get Lukovoy back as the principal suspect, because you are now the barter in that arrangement and have given Putin and the Russians the way out of not surrendering Lukoil?
I'm sorry, I just partly understood
let
what
me,
you
let
said.
Let me summarize. Yeah. In an interview with The Guardian, you called for the overthrow of the Putin government.
Overthrow.
For the fall.
Yeah. Huh? Yeah, okay.
For the fall, for the overthrow of the Putin government.
Yeah, yeah.
By doing that, haven't you, in effect, made it impossible for Britain to extradite Lugovoy? Because you are the bargaining chip.
I understand. I just want to tell you, I think there are two different questions. First of all, I just want to confirm that I call to revolution in Russia. Yeah? And I am able to explain why and so. And as far as Lugovoy is the other story, yes, how it connects to Lugovoy extradition and so. Is it correct? Yes? Two different questions. First of all, about my interview to Guardian, but I just want to stress that I present absolutely the same in January 2006, absolutely the same position to France Press. And I think that campaign would start here, but supported mainly in Russia, was just to attempt to switch attention from Litvinenko case to Berezovsky, yes, okay? And first of all, about revolution in Russia, yeah? I want to discuss in terms of definitions, yes? For me, revolution means changing of less effective society to more effective society in a political sense and in economical sense. Okay, example. Let's say at the February of 1917, Russia passed through bourgeoisie revolution when monarchy collapsed and we established the parliament which took control over the political life of Russia, which coincided with developed that time the market economy, which grows fantastically at the beginning of previous century in Russia. Lenin is contra-revolution because he changed more effective political system to less effective political system. Yeltsin made revolution in Russia, changed it less effective to more effective, and Putin is contra-revolution. It's my vision, yeah? And Russia doesn't have any chance to compete with the more effective political and economical system like you have in this country, like Europe has, like United States has. Or Russia will collapse like Soviet Union collapsed, or Russia will pass through revolution, and Russia will develop successfully. It's my vision. It doesn't depend on Putin, on some. It depends just of will and understanding of nation, finally. It is the reason why I call to revolution, and I never refuse that, but I never said that it could be cool or blood or so. It's the other story.
But you know what the term revolution means in Russian
definitely.
History.
Yeah,
in
definitely.
Russian history, the word revolution carries with it an assumption of the masses storming the seat of power and removing the rulers by force.
But I tell
that's
you...
That's what it means in Russian history.
No, but you are wrong. Because we have the other example, Orange Revolution or Rose Revolution. It's also acceptable terms in Russia today. And we know that it happened without blood. Yeah? It's a fact. But I agree with you that mainly people think about blood when they discuss about revolution. But
and when you use that term, you understood that that is what people would think, and you were handing that weapon to President Putin.
Look, I don't want to be hypocritical, like many people around. Yes, I'm sorry to say, yes. And I want to say that your country, France, Germany, everybody passed through revolution to become democratic. Mm-hmm. And in not simple way. And I would just to stress that what happened in Russia in Yeltsin time, it was very unusual because Yeltsin gave for nothing freedom to people and people didn't recognize how much it cost. And what happened in Ukraine is just a real revolution because even today we understand that the leaders of revolution are at the end of the process, because it's real people decide to be independent. And I just want to tell you that unfortunately West become very, very hypocritical. And West doesn't want to accept the reality. Yeah? And the reality is so that Russia doesn't have chance to survive as a United States, as a United States, without revolution. Because or Russia will collapse, or Russia will pass through revolution and keep as a United States. It's happened with Soviet Union. It's a typical example. And I tell you that Soviet Union collapsed not because Yeltsin was wrong, not because Gorbachev was wrong, because it's natural reality that we lost competition against of more effective systems. That's it. Okay, and the second about...
If Tony Blair tonight at the G8 meets Mr. Putin and says, give us Mr. Lugovoy, so we can complete this investigation into the killing of Litvinenko, Mr. Putin will say, give us Mr. Berezovsky, so he can come back and be held accountable for what he is charging that you have done, misdoings in Russia.
First of all, it's absolutely, again, hypocrisy, yes, because Putin, maybe, or Russian, they don't understand the law of this country. This country is not a country which change people like goods, yes? Berezovsky against of Lugovoy, or let's say oil against our responsibility and so or loyalty. Definitely, many people think like that, yes? I just want to tell you that, it was a lot of discussion after Litvinenko was died, yes? After he was poisoned and so, and I watched parliament, let's say, or journalists, and there were very many people who said Russians came here, create fantastic problem for us. They should leave us because we have enough problem without them. I just want to tell you that I put the other question. What happened? Help or destroy relations between Russia and Britain? And my answer is absolutely clear. It's help a lot in relations between Britain, United Kingdom, and Russia. Why? Because political relations are absolutely rational. It's not love, where a lot of emotions. And it's rational. And rational means to understand better each other. And today we know, you know much better who is Mr. Putin, much better. You understand much better what is Russia today under Putin control. And what is important, that Putin understand much better what you understand. And it's very important in political relations. Because I think that Alexander Litvinenko really hero of this country. Because he helped you to close your eyes to the very dangerous Putin's Russia. He helped you to understand better what you should do. Because if not so, you still have a lot of illusions. Illusions which never helpful in political relations. And again, I understand well the problem which our presence create in this country. But I am sure that it's much more helpful than anything to understand reality, unfortunately. And I understand well that I fight for my life, yes? But fighting for my life, I help you to understand better what is reality.
Question at the back here.
London based Freelancer journalist from Georgia. Mr. Berezovsky, in the same interview with Guardian, you mentioned that the revolution in Russia without blood is impossible because during the 100 years, government is raping the people in this country. This is just quote from this article. So regarding this idea, I have two questions. First, and you mentioned...
May I interrupt you?
Yes, of course.
I never mentioned that without blood, impossible to have revolution in Russia. It's absolutely wrong information. If you open all my quoted words, I never mentioned that. On the other hand, I want to be hypocritical, and I say that a lot of probability that it will be blood, but I never mentioned that. Exactly because I refer to Ukraine and to Georgia.
Okay.
I'm sorry.
So one question regarding this idea. You said that you are funding the Putin's opposition. Who is receiving money from you in Russia? Which party? Can you say the name right now or not?
Okay.
Look,
I had a meeting recently, and one journalist from Financial Times put me a question. Do you fund other Russia coalition? And I don't want to say that, to refer to my not so good English, but I did not accept that it's that he spoke about другая Россия, about very defined organization. And I answer him that definitely I fund the opposition in Russia, but I never mentioned concrete persons or organization. Because I tell you, because maybe you know, maybe not. In 2001, I start to build the new party, Liberal Russia, against Kremlin, let's say. And we were three of us, Mr. Yushenkov, Mr. Golovlev, and me. We developed that. Yushenkov is killed, Golovlev is killed, and I'm here, yeah? I like this country, but I am not my will, yes? And it's the reason why I didn't want to discover, yes, the names. But on the other hand, I thought about that after this, after these comments in Russia about everybody refused, Berezovsky does not funding us and so. You see, it's really complicated because on the one hand, if they are real opposition, they should not afraid. True, yes? And truth is so that all of them, Kasparov, Limonov, Kasyanov, they ask me of help. And I thought, the first time I tell that, yes? I tell it before because I thought about that they are not able to be strong without to tell true, yeah? And reality is so. Let's say Kasyanov, the first time I met him, he came to France, to my house. It was 1998, I think. And he asked me support to become Minister of Finance and so. I don't want to say that it's unusual that time, yes? But I don't like that if they want really to be opposition, they should be strong and to say true. We ask Berezovsky, we ask Nevzlin, we ask Khodorkovsky, we ask that. But when they try to hide reality, it doesn't work. And I think so.
Yes.
I would like to bring the conversation back to the past, please. It's a well-known fact, and you talked about it yourself in a recent film on television about how Putin came to power, that you did a lot to help him gain popularity in 1999, and that you were quite close with him and together with Sergei Daryanka on television presenter, you helped to build his image. Now, it's also known that you did a lot to bring up the evidence about the apartment bombings, about the explosions of the buildings. Now, my question is, what did you know about the explosions of the buildings then, or what did you suspect?
It's a very good question, and very complicated for me, because really I support Putin, and I believe that technology which we created that time, and technology means mass media, yes? Not to put someone in jail, not to open the case initiated by General Prosecutor Office. We believe that mass media able to change public opinion and so on. And you may believe me, you may not, because it's complicated to believe me in that point, yes? I really did not connect house explosions to Putin activity at that time. Because I believe that we have enough power to put him in chair. And when I moved to this country and when I returned back in my mind and start to investigate what happened, and I recognized that houses explosions were organized parallel team, which was created, I don't know by whom, maybe Putin, maybe people around him, maybe KGB, former KGB people. But again, you may believe me, you may not believe me, it's up to you. I didn't know anything about this parallel system which support him. Because as I told you before, I believe that just chair of prime minister allow everyone who is in this chair to become president.
But let me ask you this question. Let me ask you this question. You were well connected in Chechnya. You knew people in Chechnya. They trusted you?
Definitely.
Surely you must have thought at the time, there's something suspicious about this.
Okay. I tell you the story, which is story, yes? In June, maybe May 99, I had a visitor from Chechnya who told me that they plan at the end of the summer, at the beginning of autumn, a big military operation in Dagestan. Mm-hmm. And as far as they knew that I'm friendly with them, the separatists, they asked my advice. And I told them that it's completely wrong, because now they have fantastic international support, mm-hmm. and if they do that, they will lose everything. Next day, I came to Stepashin, who that time was mm-hmm. prime minister of Russia, mm-hmm. and told him about that. And he said, Boris, don't worry, we know about that. Don't worry, we are well protected. And then in August 99, as you remember maybe, they had attack, Chechen attack, Dagestan. Mm-hmm. It was completely stupid, without any chance to get result. Yeah, and we have a lot of evidence now that it was organized by FSB. A lot of evidence, including Basayev's story and so on. So. And I, as far as you told, I wasn't deeply involved in that, and I have also a lot of different evidence
story. Was there no part of your mind at that time, at the time of the apartment bombings, yeah. that thought, this is the FSB,
no.
and therefore Putin is...
May I tell you? Nothing. No, just again, you want my answer? Nothing. I did not think at all about this, because as I told you, I was in close relations with Putin, and we developed some stream, yes, how to make that, yes, and no one time anybody mentioned me about the additional power which, let's say, put bombing attack and so. Again, I did not, me personally, I did not know anything. I knew that, but I never calculated that time that it's organized by FSB. Moreover, I tell you, if I would be, okay, now speculation, yes? If I would be involved in that, I never tried to fight to discover that, yes? Because if I will be part of the plot, I never try to convince people to investigate that.
But
yes?
Some people said it at the time. So it was speculated about even the day after the first of the apartment bombings. Many people on the streets of Moscow, I remember this very clearly, people in the you know, upper circles of political life were saying, FSB.
Okay, again, you want my answer? Mm. I gave that. I did not think that time that Putin, because Putin and FSB is the same, yes?
Okay.
And I didn't think that time that Putin is involved in that.
Okay. Is there anybody here from the FSB? Yeah, I bet there is. Yes, there's a lady with her hand up there.
you said that revolution for you is change from a non-effective system to a more effective system.
It's definition.
Yeah. But
my definition, but you may put the other one.
In the eyes of many Russians, though, Putin presence has been very effective because less people are in poverty. Natural resources are back to Russians, so there, you know, we had the example last week of BP, but Shell, regions which were depressed, like Tatarstan, are booming. Last year, the benchmark index in the Moscow Stock Exchange gained enormously. So how can you convince the majority of Russians that Putin is not effective? Yes, Yeltsin changed, in your words, he was liberal, he gave freedom of speech, but it was a mess. We saw what happened economically in 98. Now the situation is better. So I'm not talking about human rights or freedom of speech, I'm just talking about day-to-day life. So how can you convince Russians, the majority of them, that you can get that Putin is not effective?
Good. First of all, I just want to confirm that Putin has fantastic popularity in Russia, 70%, maybe more. The Russian economy is growing, definitely. The point is different. You remember the German economy also growing in Hitler time, yes? Enormous, yeah? And moreover, based not just on natural resources, based on intellectual power, yeah? And you know that Ukrainian economy before Orange Revolution, also growing fantastic, 12%. And nevertheless, revolution happened. And we discuss not about absolute terms, but we discuss about relative terms, yes? And it's absolutely clear that, let's say, if we take Spain in Franco time or Portuguese in Salazar time, they were in the end of the Europe, and now it's pitch is different. And it's absolutely clear that the Putin success, let's say this time success, based on two elements. The first is reform of Yeltsin. Very painful reform. But I want to mention that many people discuss reform just in terms of mechanisms. Market economy, elections and so on. But the basis of reform are mentality. Many people, millions of people, accept to be independent from state. They develop personal activity. And economy which we have today in Russia based on the personal activity which created by Yeltsin. It took time, but it's happened. And the second point definitely is oil prices and gas prices, yes? And on the one hand, Putin just used success of Yeltsin reform, which is natural. On the other hand, the world economy structurized like that, that oil prices and gas prices are very important. Yeah. On the other hand, I don't want to, I don't want to reduce the Putin way, yes, the Putin activity. Because what is clear, that on the one hand, he tried to create so-called state capitalism. On the other hand, there are a lot of positive reform in economy. Let's say tax, for example, 13% tax, definitely very positive for Russian economy. I just want to tell you, I don't want to just say that Putin is wrong completely and so. I think that he's wrong generally, yes? Wrong that he's trying to move Russia back and so. But objectively, market economy, which still exists in Russia, is more effective than planning economy. And the conjecture of the market, of the world market, is very, very in favor for Russia. It's a reality. I just want to tell you that if, let's say, Putin continue Yeltsin way of reform, Russia will be much more successful than now. Because if, as you know, we don't have any reform and structurization of production in Russia. We don't have any real basis which we're able to create using these prices, using this.
So what will happen to Russia if the oil and gas price falls drastically? What would happen to Putin's fortunes if the oil and gas price were to fall over the next 12 months?
First of all, I want to tell that, do you know Tom Graham?
No.
Okay. Tom Graham was the second secretary of the United States in the Yeltsin time in Russia, and then he became the number one advisor of Bush in White House. Mm-hmm. And he wrote article in 2001, I think, that Russia doesn't mean anything more, Russia is not powerful more, and we should put Russia as a third range state and so on. To answer to your question, first of all, I return back to Bzezinski, if you allow me. Zbigniew Bzezinski, his book, this great, the Velika Shakhmat Daska, great chessboard, yes. And he wrote that who controlled Euro-Asia controlled the world. I agree with him. And Russia still controlled the Euro-Asia. And just because of geographical position, Russia is important. Mm. But if to add that intellectual power, which is a result of intersection, of genetic intersection, of West and East, North and South, and if you look to Russian women, you recognize that it's real, yes? It's real intersection, and it's real beauty, yeah? And on the other hand, it's and the third point is a lot of resources. And it means that Russia is really big, big power, was and is and will be.
Even if the price of oil were to collapse?
Agree. Absolutely. Because, you know...
But Putin would not be so confident on the world stage.
No, it's the other point. We don't discuss about Putin. You ask me about Russia, yes? And it will not damage Russia, believe me. No, it definitely, oil prices affect. Yes?
But if Yeltsin had benefited from the oil prices in his decade...
Different story.
It would have been a different story.
Absolutely different story.
There's a question here.
Yes, Boris Abramovich. I want to ask you about your allies, the people you've helped over the years, Litvinenko, obviously, Yushchenko. Was it Rybkin in the last elections? They tended to end up in either dead or in a bad situation. I'm just wondering whether you think it might not be better for them if you didn't help them at all.
Good and naive question. Naive because it was not my choice. It was choice of Alexander Litvinenko. It was choice of Yushchenko. It was their will how to make their life. Yeah? And I tell you, maybe the best example is nevertheless Alexander Litvinenko. Because he told me, Boris, I am sure that they are prepared to kill us. But it's my choice. It's not money sense. Yeah? And I tell you maybe the other story about Darienko. You know, Russian journalist, very famous in Yeltsin time, Darienko, who really played fantastic story in elections of Putin. And maybe you don't remember that, but rating of Primakov and Lushkov, they were together, yeah, was much more over 50%, and rating of Putin and Yeltsin at the beginning was very low. And Darienko came to me and said, because he was fired from TV by Kremlin, some people, I don't want don't want to go into the details. And he said to me, Boris, I understand that we lose, but I want to fight for that and to be killed. It's not my point. He said that, and we will win. But I told him, Sergei, we win definitely. He said, okay, if we even lose, I prepare to be killed. And it's just choice of personality. Yeah, I never convince Alexander Litvinenko or Yushchenkov or other who were killed or in jail now, like Trepashkin, for example, to follow me. It's their personal choice. And really, the question is why I'm still alive. Yes, because I drank white wine with Lugovoy day before he poisoned Litvinenko.
So you do think Lugovoy poisoned?
Look. It's a lot of evidence of that. Yes? And even chair where Lugovoy was sitting at the 31st, day before Litvinenko was poisoned, 800 times more radiation than the place where Litvinenko stayed. Yes? Yeah. And I like your joke, but unfortunately, some people pay life for that.
I know. There's a question, I think, from Georgian television.
Yes, sir. Do you know that Lugovoy, before coming to London, traveled to Tbilisi to meet a close ally of yours, Padre Patrakatsishvili? And do you think this meeting was somehow linked to what happened in London? And why Litvinenko? Why him?
Okay, you see, there are two different questions. Mm-hmm. First of all, until now, Lugovoy, close friend of Badri. And there is one argument which, for me, still I don't have answer. Because Lugovoy visited Badri Patrakatsishvili in Tbilisi around 17-18 of November. It means after what happened with Alexander Litvinenko. If Lugovoy was involved in that, he never, I think.
Actually, I have seen the copy of his visa and the invitation from Patrakatsishvili Foundation.
Yeah.
And and I've seen the copy of the of his documents at the border at the Tbilisi airport, and he definitely visited Tbilisi before London.
No.
Before when?
Before he came to London to visit Litvinenko.
I speak this story. I don't know. He visited many times Badri, yes, and I don't know. I don't know anything detailed. But I discuss now about I think more important point. As far as Lugovoy's story is concerned, because he visited Badri after what happened at the 1st of November. I don't want to mention that he poisoned like you.
Yeah, she thinks he visited before.
Just a moment. No. Before it's... And what? He visited before many times.
Okay.
We discuss now why he visited him after. If he was one of the killer, yeah? And he knew well that relations between Georgia and Russia are very, very bad, yes? It means that if he really understood that he is killer, why he left Russia to go to Georgia to take this risk? This is the real question. I don't understand that. It's the reason why I tell, why I told that I believe in the investigation of Scotland Yard 100%, and believe in conclusion of Crown Prosecutor Office.
Okay,
but
I
don't understand.
We're going to leave
some
details. If you like the Georgian angle there and move to. There's a question up there. And then one down here.
Hello. I'd like to return to the question from the lady on my right. No one doubts that Russia's growth has been phenomenal in the last.
So, sorry.
Would you stand up?
I'm sorry.
Yeah.
No one doubts that Russian growth has been phenomenal in the last 3 or 4 years, but how are you and perhaps Mr. Kasparov going to convince the Russian people that change is required?
I'm sorry, could you translate from English into English, please? I'm sorry.
I mean, it's a similar question to the lady here. Yeah. The thrust of it is most Russian people now feel better off under Putin than they felt under Yeltsin, because under Yeltsin they felt that people like you were getting very rich at their expense. How can you persuade most Russian people that the Yeltsin years were better than what they have now?
First of all, I would like to say that it's just history able to give the answer to this question, yes? And definitely impossible to wait this answer from me. It's just absolutely clear that Yeltsin created revolution in Russia, and all the time the revolution is very painful for everybody. And many people don't like that, yes? The result, finally, which happened in 10 years, as we know now, or in 20 years, they like the result. And I just want to tell you that I believe that in, let's say, 20 years, maybe less, Yeltsin and Gorbachev will become the biggest hero of Russian history.
Okay, let's take a question here. We've got time for perhaps for two or three more questions. Yes.
Why was the Orange Revolution successful in Ukraine? And why do most people dismiss the notion of an Orange Revolution happening in Russia? What makes Ukraine different?
Okay. It's a simple and complicated question. Because if we move from the east to the west, we find more and more freedom. Yeah? And as you know, Russia is compared with Ukraine on the east. Yes? I think that what happened in Ukraine is absolutely amazing, because it happened from the bottom. Yeah? And moreover, the leaders of revolution were on the back compared with the people, which what become clear after revolution, yeah? Like Yushchenko, let's say, behavior, like all the other leaders. And I, but I think that, again, we should again define what means revolution. Revolution means mentality changes, yes? And I think that the way from slave to free, to be free, has two stages. The first stage is recognition that to be independent is much better than to be dependent. Yes? It's not a simple story, because, again, I am absolutely Soviet, and I like to be in Soviet Union. I was protected by state, yes, and I love that. Yeah? And then when I smell the freedom, I recognize that it's better. Yeah? And this understanding happened not just with me, it happened with the millions of people in Russia. Yeah? But it's the first stage to be free. The second stage is to fight every day for your freedom against of your government. Even in this country, which is the most liberal in the world, as I understand, the most liberal in the world, every day people fight for the freedom. Take example with the Iraq war, when 1.5 million people went to the street fight against of government decision, when 400 people went to the street fight against of law which against of hunting dogs against a fox. Yes, 400,000 people. It means that what Goethe said, that only, I'm sorry, I'm not able to be poet in poetry way in English, but only those one are able to be happy and free if he fight for that every day. And Russian people were not prepared to fight every day for that. And those who said that Maidan already in the past, they absolutely didn't understand. Maidan forever, because people decide to fight every day for freedom. And there's a difference between Ukrainian and Russian.
Okay, this is a huge philosophical question now, but I'm going to take two more questions. One from Charlotte Eger.
You obviously appreciate many things about this country, but would you like to return home to Russia? And if so, under what terms? What do you miss about it? And when are you going to go home and how?
First of all, okay, my wife said, Boris, we should say thanks Putin that our children are here. Okay. Yeah, it's one part of the answer. The other part of the answer is that, as far as personally me concerned, I learned so much, not alone. because it's impossible just to read Shakespeare or Dickens or other and to understand what is different. You should be inside of this country. And I like distance between people, yes? Not so close, not too far, yes? But, I got fantastic experience. And I tell you that I really, okay, if you ask me who I am as a professional today, I'm a politician, yes? It doesn't matter that it's a businessman or a mathematician and so on, I'm a politician, yeah? And I tell you, for my personal experience, to be in this country is amazing. If I would, let's say, influence without this experience in Russia all the time, I will be not so precise like I am now.
Let me just focus back to Lottie's question. I mean, the English word nostalgia, which most people think nostalgia is a longing for the past. In fact, the proper meaning is a longing for home.
Yeah.
Do you experience a yearning for home?
Okay. First of all, I miss snow.
Yes.
Okay. The most what I miss, it's really snow.
Okay.
The rational answer is, I don't accept that anyone able not allow me to be back in my country. This is the basic point. Not nostalgia. I'm sorry, yes? I don't have nostalgia, yes? But I am absolutely against that someone, not me, took a decision that I'm not able to return back to Russia. This
so
is the point.
How could you go home? What will make you
No, wait a minute. Home? No, hold on. We have to... I promise to take one more question, and it's from the back.
Oh, okay. Sorry.
Yeah, no. And then we're going to wrap up because we're already over our time. Sorry, Lottie.
Alex Goldfarb in a book with Marina Litvinenko suggested you are leading this campaign against Putin out of a sense of atonement, that you feel guilty about raising this man to the leadership of Russia. Do you feel guilty about Putin and your role in making him president?
Definitely. I feel guilty. Not maybe exactly in these terms, but I feel that I am responsible for what happened in Russia, yes, after Putin took power. But again, I just want to tell that I was not a decision maker. Yeah, it doesn't mean that I am not guilty, yes. I was one who helped Putin to take power. More, I just want to tell you that finally, it was a battle between Putin and Primakov, as you remember. Yeah? And even today, I would like to say that I prefer Putin than Primakov, because Primakov would move Russia the same direction, but he's a very clever man. Yeah? And this is a basic point, yes? And Putin have done so much mistakes for the last time. Yeah? And I tell you, what really I pay my time, it's not answer to your question, it's just additionally. I pay my time for last years just to explain on the West who is Mr. Putin. Yeah? And I tell you that in 2001, when I have the same audience, even big or less, very smart, very intellectual people, I was just alone. And they told me, Boris, you are absolutely wrong. You are a corrupt man. You convinced government to be corrupt. And you left Russia because Putin started to fight against of oligarchs. And you left. And today, completely different. I don't have any resistance, unfortunately. Yes?
Because in 2001, everybody thought Putin was a good thing. Everybody in the West.
No, absolutely, yes. But I'm happy. I don't want to say that it's my... it's a result of my fight, but I really like that people start to be critical, at least, yes? And it's so that it's the other story now.
Okay. We're way past our time. We have many fascinating conversations here at the Frontline Club. This has been one of the most fascinating I've ever come to. Please thank Boris Berezovsky.
Yeah, thank you.